Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Kelly Ubel, General Counsel for Assurant. Kelly joined the screening industry in 2011 following several years working in the electronic discovery, computer forensics, and data recovery space. In her current role, Kelly oversees the teams responsible for counseling staff on legal and regulatory risks and requirements. This includes providing subject matter expertise and monitoring and evaluating proposed and existing laws and regulations from the local, state, federal, and international level that impact background screening. In addition to her role at Assurant, Kelly serves on the board of directors for the National Association of Professional Background Screeners, NAPBS. In this capacity, Kelly also acts as board liaison to the Government Relations Committee, where she previously served as co-chair from 2015 through 2017. The Government Relations Committee, in conjunction with NAPBS's lobbyists on the state and federal level, is responsible for tracking and combating potential legislative and regulatory changes that negatively impact CRAs and employers. Kelly also serves on the Advocacy Committee, which fosters relationships with other industries and employer associations. Previously, Kelly worked as general counsel for InfoCubic, legal counsel for global regulatory affairs for First Advantage, and as compliance officer focused on domestic and international screening issues for Verifications, Inc. Prior to joining the background screening industry, Kelly worked as a law clerk and attorney focused on thought leadership for Kroll On Track. Kelly holds a law degree from William Mitchell College of Law and received her Bachelor of Arts in Political Science with a concentration on law and politics, and a major in management from the University of Minnesota Twin Cities. Kelly is also admitted to the Minnesota Bar. Assurant provides technology-enabled, customizable background screening solutions for HR recruitment teams that result in faster turnaround times and more comprehensive records than traditional single county searches, eliminating the manual, labor-intensive background screenings. Their approach also seamlessly integrates with existing applicant tracking system software to give an end-to-end view of the hiring cycle and create a more efficient workflow. With Assurant, the HR industry can shorten the hiring cycle and onboard the best talent for their organization. You can learn more about Assurant at www.assurant.com. In today's webinar, a quick overview here, staying current with compliance in your hiring process is a critical component of running your staffing business. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Kelly will review the biggest news in employment law across the U.S. so far this year, including COVID-19's impact on background screening, an overview of legislation passed so far in 2020, and drug testing litigation updates. By the end of this session, you'll be in the know as it relates to compliance in your hiring process. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat feature. After the presentation, there will be time for some questions. With that, I will turn the floor over to Kelly.
Great, thank you so much. And apologies that you had to read through that incredibly long bio. I promise next time we'll give you a much more condensed version, because really the most important thing here today is that we're all here to talk about compliance, and particularly compliance as it relates to background screening. You know, the landscape only becomes more complex as we navigate through, you know, each year, and especially with the COVID pandemic impacting the marketplace and just everyday life, you know, we've seen an impact to background screening as well. So I definitely want to touch on that. But before I get started, you know, if anyone's ever attended a webinar with me before, you know, I do come with a disclaimer, especially since I am a lawyer. And just want to note that none of this is offered as legal advice. And so while I am a lawyer, I'm not your lawyer. And I really encourage all of you to consult with qualified legal counsel on anything we talk about today or any questions you may have regarding your background screening program. So today we have a lot of content to get through, but we definitely will have time for questions. So please feel free to submit questions using the Q&A feature. We again, will have time to get to them. We're gonna start with COVID-19's impact on screening and then switch over to provide an overview as to what's been happening in the legislative and litigation space over the last 7 months now. I almost said six. I'm still stuck in June. I can't believe it's almost the end of July. And then we'll touch on really what has become one of the hottest topics, which is marijuana and its impact on drug testing. And again, that's probably been one of the bigger trends from 2019 that has led over into 2020 as well. So we will spend some time on some trends we're seeing in case law related to drug testing and marijuana, as well as some steps for you all to consider with your programs. So as we move into July, it really has become a whole new world for employers over the last several months. You know, you have, as employers, a host of new laws to deal with, from the FFCRA, not to be confused with the FCRA, or the Fair Credit Reporting Act. There's guidance given under the CARES Act. There's EEOC guidance on what you can and cannot do as it relates to COVID testing, accommodations, all of those things. So especially if you have started to bring people back into your workplace, there's new OSHA guidance. The Department of Labor has published FAQs related to all these new paid sick leave laws. So you're dealing with a lot as an employer. And we're not gonna cover any of this, these specific laws today, because I do wanna focus more on the background screening impact, but I didn't want to just breeze through this as though nothing has changed. You know, it is something that you have to deal with now and keep in mind as you move forward in managing your employee relationships. So let's switch to what really is impacting us from a background screening standpoint. So early on in the pandemic, you know, we saw a lot of court closures, which was pretty understood given that the majority of the country had started to shut down in some capacity. Not every state, of course, shut down, but we did see a lot of court closures, and that did impact things like court record availability, turnaround time, and just that general fulfillment. And so, you know, this is one of the reasons that Assurant has placed just so much emphasis on aggregating data and working to automate sources such as county courts as much as possible. You know, we can and we did help reduce the impact that our clients felt with some of these wide-scale court closures. Which is important because it's not just pandemics that close courts, but it's also things like weather events. You know, we're into hurricane season, which can create some disruptions in inability to get records, for example. So just something that we've really worked hard to help minimize the impact of over time. If you are interested in any updates as it relates to court closures and then court reopenings, because a lot of courts have reopened or in the process of reopening, feel free to visit our website there. You can find all of those updates. We also posted a host of candidate resources and client notifications. So, you know, candidates are still involved in the process, right? And arguably more so now than prior to the pandemic, they're eager to have that job in some cases. I know we've heard from some of our staffing clients that the extra amounts given in unemployment benefits have actually been hampering their ability to fill empty positions because potentially people are making more on unemployment than not. And it remains to be seen what's going to happen with, you know, any of the new proposals that are still being negotiated on the Hill, if that benefit would be extended, expired, or what they're going to do as an alternative. But, you know, candidates that want to have that work, you know, they are just as involved in the process as they were before and could have a lot of questions about delays in their backgrounds. So we wanted to make sure candidates felt like they were taken care of as well. We also did see, you know, an impact to things like education and employment verifications. With businesses and schools shut down, a vast majority of the workforce that can work from home is still working from home, with some exceptions, of course. And of course, there's always those roles that have to be in the workplace in order to fulfill their duties. But that does impact, you know, responsiveness. We started to see an improvement in that as well as things reopen and life sort of inches closer to normal than what it was before. But just be aware that, you know, if you run those types of products, there may still be a slight delay due to all these closures that we've seen. And then finally, the product we got a lot of questions on as well was drug testing. And really, it came from a lot of candidates who were concerned about having to go to a lab and potential exposure to the virus, to other people carrying the virus. And so, you know, what was really important to emphasize there is that a lot of the collection sites weren't actually offering COVID-19 testing. You know, that may continue to evolve and change as time goes on. You know, we're really seeing a huge emphasis on testing around the country. But a lot of labs have instituted requirements such as wearing a mask, staying in your car until it's time for your appointment, things like that. And so candidates are encouraged to review their drug testing passports or to call the clinic that they're going to in advance just to make sure if there are special instructions, they're aware of them. More and more states are mandating masks, as are some cities. So it's becoming a bit more commonplace. But, you know, if they were to show up without one and one is required, you know, that obviously could delay the drug test. So important to really work to educate your candidates as well on the fact that there may be these additional requirements and they may want to reach out and talk to the clinic about that. So what should you do, right? So things are a little bit different now than they were necessarily in March and April, but there are still potential delays with some courts still remaining closed, or the courts that are reopening now are quite backlogged, and so their ability to respond for criminal record requests may still take longer than normal. They may have less people working in the courts, for example, less clerks, staggered schedules. So we are still seeing some impacts even with courts opening. So, you know, you do have various options to consider, and we've talked to clients that have kind of explored these options and potentially even more. And of course, there's pros and cons, right? So, you know, one option is to move forward with allowing the person to start to work and then address any issues that might come up once the background check is completed. And this may be something that employers do as a standard practice already. Not every employer waits for the background check to be completed before putting that person on a work site or allowing them to start performing their roles. And, you know, we've always kind of cautioned employers against that practice because one of the reasons background checks are done in the first place is safety, right? So allowing someone to start, then realizing that maybe they did have criminal history that could pose a safety concern or is job related, you know, that may put you in a tough spot as an employer and potentially expose you to something like a negligent hiring lawsuit if something were to go wrong. You know, maybe that person commits some sort of act that that you should have never been in that position in the first place, because the background check would have shown that, hey, they have a recent history of XYZ offense, it's job related, or it could impact their ability to interact with the public or with your other employees. So usually waiting for the background check results to be completed is going to be probably one of the safer choices out there. Another option is just canceling searches that are delayed for COVID-19 reasons and then running those again later. And these kind of have some of the same concerns as the option we just talked about of delaying or allowing a person to start before the background check is done. I mean, there is still an issue that they could have criminal history in those jurisdictions that are delayed that you chose to have canceled that could be impactful to them. And then, you know, I've attended a lot of other webinars on this topic over the past several months, and there's been an excellent point brought up consistently here that doing this can also put your argument as to why your use of criminal history is job related at risk. Because if you're allowing people to start without this complete background check, they're doing a great job. They're clearly performing the role to expectations. There hasn't been any sort of safety concerns either. And then you decide to go back and rerun them and this criminal history pops up. What are you going to do then? Because you've almost started to lose your argument that it's job related because they've been able to perform the role. And so now maybe you have some potential EEOC issues. And so it really just complicates your management of the situation as an employer. But of course, you need to end up making the decision that you think is best for you. And so this is where your legal counsel can be really helpful. I would just remind you that employers, you still have to be cognizant of the FCRA and the Fair Credit Reporting Act, any applicable state laws. Those laws did not get lifted or suspended. They still very much apply to screening. So things like making sure you have appropriate consent or what's referred to as a disclosure and authorization, making sure you follow adverse action, all of that's going to be really important to still comply with. And then when we start talking about bringing people back to the workplace, you know, what should you do if you had employees maybe furloughed or otherwise separated from your workforce? You know, you may want to consider at a minimum conducting criminal checks on them again, depending on how long they've been separated from your workplace. I mean, it is possible that they maybe committed a crime while they were out of work, just like it's possible that your current employees could have committed crimes. So a lot of employers are looking into how do I kind of rescreen my employee base. It's something that Assurant does with our own employees. We rescreen them routinely to see if anything's changed with their history since they were initially hired. And it's something that's a really popular topic right now in the industry in terms of how do we continue to evaluate not just candidates, but our employees as well. So let's move on to just some legislation and litigation that we've seen. And overall, on the legislative front, it's been a lot slower in 2020, particularly on the state level and the local level. A lot of states either went out of session temporarily or cut their session short, or really focused on things like COVID-related legislation, right? How did they want to address the pandemic, provide protections for consumers, help people within their state or their city? So a lot of focus has remained on the pandemic and continues to remain there on the federal level as well. You know, we hear a lot of activity coming out of the federal government related to additional stimulus packages or, you know, I mentioned the unemployment issues and discussions that are currently ongoing. So it's just taking a lot of focus away from other types of issues. So normally we see a lot more activity on these trends, which have really remained the most popular trends over the last year to 2 years. And the first is ban the box type laws, whether that's for criminal history or salary history. So if you're newer to the concept, a criminal history ban the box law really started as a way to remove the criminal history question from an initial employment application and put it later on in the process. The whole goal of this effort is really kind of a subset of the broader criminal justice reform movement that you see there as the second trend, which is how can we help those with a prior criminal history get back into the employment space? Having that gainful employment may reduce the risk that they reoffend later, for example. You know, that's kind of the argument that's tied to this movement. We've seen some ban the box activity, mostly on the city level this year. I'll highlight on the next slide one of the cities that recently passed and had that legislation go into effect. But it is still a focus area. It's something that has crossed the partisan divide. It's not a Democrat versus Republican or progressive versus conservative issue necessarily anymore. States that are historically quote unquote red have also considered, you know, this type of legislation or cities within those states. So it really is becoming more of a generally accepted topic and area to try and look at. The President Obama's administration had started the White House Fair Chance Pledge and had a big focus in this area that has continued under President Trump's administration. So again, you don't see as much of a partisan divide in that issue anymore, which is why we start to see more and more laws passed more easily without as much resistance. We've also seen more laws on expungements, trying to make expungements easier to get, allowing for automatic expungements to happen. And this is interesting because we started to see more of that type of legislation around marijuana in particular. So as marijuana becomes legalized recreationally in more and more states, or decriminalized, and there is a difference between those two terms, states are looking at, well, okay, so we have this whole host of people with prior marijuana-related convictions. Those are no longer considered crimes in today's world. So what should we do? And so some states, like Illinois, for example, have considered expungements. Like, how can we get these prior marijuana-related convictions off of a person's record since they're no longer crimes today? So we see a lot of focus on that topic in particular. I'm going to talk about marijuana a little later, so I'll leave that be for now, except to just say, again, probably one of the most popular things that are being discussed. And it's really picked up activity on a case law perspective, and I'll give you some case examples a little bit later. So what are some examples of some of the laws that have passed? Because even though it's quieter, things are still happening. There's still a changing landscape you need to be aware of depending on where you hire. One example is Maryland. So salary history legislation was super popular 2018 going into 2019. We've seen less of it so far in 2020, but Maryland did hop on that bandwagon recently with their law going into effect on October 1st. And like many other salary history laws, the whole point of this type of legislation is that you're not requiring a candidate or asking for this information to be given to you related to their wage or salary history. So a lot of these laws say you can ask for it once a conditional offer is extended that includes compensation, but the goal is to try and level the playing field with an eye on the fact that historically women have earned less than men in roles, right? That's been pretty common discussion over the last how many years. And so a lot of these laws have really tried to start to narrow that gap by taking prior salary history off the table and instead requiring employers to essentially set the standard for wage for the role. So Maryland does that. It also includes the fact that you can't get wage history from a current or former employer, whether you're asking them or whether your third-party agent, i.e. background screening provider, is asking for that information. So it's important if you work with someone besides Assurance to your background screening, make sure you ask them how they treat these bills. So with Assurance, we don't ask for salary information as a standard. You would actually have to tell us to go get that information. And we would, you know, kind of spark that discussion with you on, hey, just so you know, there's a whole host of states where you can't legally be asking for this. So we're not going to. But so all background screening providers don't necessarily treat it the same way. So important to have that discussion. Transitioning to the Waterloo law I mentioned, they did pass a ban the box law. I think it's the first one in Iowa to be passed. And it was upheld after a lawsuit was filed, claiming that there was no essentially rights for the city to pass that law based on a state law that exists. So it was filed by the Iowa Association of Business and Industry, but a judge upheld the law, determining that a city has every right to address civil rights issues, and it viewed this ban the box law as a civil rights issue. So the law did go into effect July 1st. Again, hard to believe it's already almost the end of July. So if you're hiring in Waterloo and potentially impacted, you will want to review that legislation. The city did publish a 55-minute or so training presentation on the law to provide an overview of it, how it interplays with things like the Fair Credit Reporting Act. They have links to a lot of different resources from things like SHRM, for example. So highly encourage you to check that out if you are impacted by that law. Assurant also has a blog post on our blog with more information and a link to those resources as well. So two other examples to highlight before we turn to litigation are some different types of laws that we haven't really seen a ton of over the years. So I wanted to highlight them just to show how states are tackling different types of issues. And the first comes out of Kentucky. So Kentucky did something a little different, and they passed Senate Bill 191. The employer-related provisions of this law actually go into effect today, July 23rd. And so really, according to the bill, the point of this legislation was to foster economic opportunities for individuals that have a history of substance use disorder or substance abuse. And so the legislation tried to create incentives for employers to encourage participation in treatment programs versus just terminating those individuals, for example, that may have an issue with substance use. And so there are specific actions that employers need to take in order to be eligible for the program. This includes things like developing a written drug policy, requiring employee participation in treatment services, and a right to discipline or retain or to terminate rather employees that don't end up complying with treatment or the drug policy. So you're not required to pay for treatment. You may do so if you choose to as an employer, but this law, by complying with this, actually provides the employer some great protections against civil liability for lawsuits alleging negligent hiring, negligent retention, or negligent supervision. And those lawsuits can be pretty tricky for employers to navigate. So it is nice to see a state, you know, try and balance giving people another chance and a way to get treatment, a way to get well, with providing employers protections in the event that the employer is trying to do the right thing and something goes wrong. They have, again, some of those protections there. Finally, Virginia did something a little different and essentially passed a ban the box law for marijuana. So it's not really something we've seen before. And so, you know, it'll be interesting to see what happens with this law. It did go into effect July 1st of this year, so we're about 23 days in now. But as part of the bill, employers cannot inquire into any arrest, charge, or conviction for a simple possession of marijuana charge, because essentially that's no longer a crime in Virginia. Instead, it's now a civil penalty with a small fine, and so no longer a conviction. I guess somewhat ironically, if you will, employers that violate this law can actually lead to a Class 1 misdemeanor for each violation, so really important for employers to be cognizant that this law exists and comply with it. Now, the only caveat here is that if an individual is operating a commercial motor vehicle at the time, the violation will be reported still on the individual's MVR, record. So that would be something you would see not on a criminal search, but an MVR search in the state of Virginia moving forward. It does allow individuals to seek expungement for past marijuana convictions that are covered by this law, you know, something we just talked about. So an interesting approach, and it'll be, you know, something we track to see if this type of trend continues to take off in other states as well. So let's move on to litigation. So when the pandemic originally started happening, you know, common thought was, well, hey, maybe this will be positive from a litigation standpoint, potentially, as courts are shutting down or moving to more virtual formats. You know, we weren't quite sure what was going to happen with the litigation landscape. And we've essentially seen a bit of a roller coaster over the last several months. So I have a couple months highlighted here that, you know, we saw a slight decrease initially, then it jumped back up. And then June, I saw another spike downwards. And so it's unclear why we're seeing this roller coaster of litigation. And this is focused on FCRA litigation around the country. But FCRA litigation is still up 8.2% year to date as compared to last year. It is important to caveat that all of this is not FCRA lawsuits against employers, right? So it includes, you know, background screen providers and includes other parts of the FCRA, or like debt collection, for example. So it's not just background screening for employment, but you can see the FCRA remains a really popular place for plaintiff's attorneys to kind of hang their hat and really pursue cases against various individuals. We've seen a whole host of disclosure-related cases in the beginning of 2020 in March and April, and these three cases are actually all out of the same circuit, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And the Ninth Circuit, in particular, is often looked to within the country because it includes California, and California has its own specific state laws on the use of consumer report information, has disclosure requirements that are imposed upon employers, for example, and is a very litigated state, you know, which I don't think is a surprise to anyone, right? So California is just a popular place for these cases to be filed. But we'll start with the first case, and so this came out of 2020. And this case in particular is a great read for employers because the court did something that courts don't normally do, or at least that we haven't seen. It actually took essentially a paragraph by paragraph comparison of the employer's disclosure form and said, yes, we think this does violate the SOLE requirement, or no, we think it doesn't violate the SOLE requirement. And so there's kind of two key parts of the disclosure requirements. One is that than a document that consists solely of the disclosure, and the other really looks at clear and concise. Do you have extra information in there that may make the form confusing for candidates to review? So this court focused more on the solely piece, but again, interesting to see their analysis of the actual disclosure form and kind of their paragraph by paragraph review. So the court did find that as an employer, you can describe what a consumer report is, you know, what that entails, how you're going to obtain that consumer report, and for what type of employment purposes that it may be used for. So you do have some free rein there to include some details. The court also looked at things like investigative consumer report language, for example, which is kind of a tricky area that we can save for another day, but really look at your disclosure form and see kind of do you have a bunch of extra stuff on there or not. And this would be a great thing to have reviewed by your legal counsel or engage outside legal counsel to take a look at it at least on an annual basis. So I'll just take a step back. Your disclosure forms, your adverse action, we recommend having that reviewed at least annually, if not more frequently, because things continue to change with case law and different allegations that plaintiff's attorneys are coming up with. The other part of this first case that was interesting was that the plaintiff claimed that their the employer violated the adverse action requirements because the employer didn't include contact information for the plaintiff to reach out to at the employer to talk about the consumer report with. And so the court said, well, nice argument, but that doesn't really matter because the FCRA doesn't tell employers they have to do that. The FCRA instead tells employers they have to include the consumer reporting agency information so that way a candidate can reach out, talk to the background screen provider that prepared the report, see if anything is inaccurate or incomplete, and then file what we call a dispute. So saying, hey, something doesn't seem right, I want you to go back through and do what we call a reinvestigation into this report information. So since the employer had that in their letter, the court didn't allow that claim to move forward. The next case, also again out of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit in March, the plaintiff here claimed that the employer violated the SCRA due to an inadequate disclosure form, and because the disclosure form was inadequate, there was no meaningful authorization obtained. That's a pretty common claim in these disclosure form cases against employers. And the disclosure form at issue contained a liability waiver, references to state law, and was included as part of a larger employment application. So it's a lot of things that we say or have seen in other cases that have created a lot of issues for employers. Now, in this particular case, there was a lot of discovery exchange in it. The court determined that the plaintiff didn't produce any evidence that there was a harm caused, and so for that reason, that the claim was not successful. But again, we've seen a lot of settlements in the hundreds of thousands to multi-million dollars against employers who have had things like liability waivers or state law references on the disclosure form. So again, that's why it's really good to have those forms reviewed on a routine basis. The final case was a little bit more interesting. It's a type of claim that we don't see often, and it has to do with timing. So in this case, the employer here provided a disclosure form at the same time as other employment-related materials, which is pretty common when you use applicant tracking systems, for example. You have, perhaps an employee collection form, you have them look at your consent forms, your disclosure authorization. If you're running additional searches, like through PSP, for example, there are specific forms for that. So the employer here was a transportation company and had a lot of other requirements. But the court dismissed the argument and said that there's really no problem with providing the disclosure at the same time as these other employment materials because the disclosure was on its own piece of paper. It was a concise and to the point disclosure. There was nothing confusing about the language. So there the employer was successful. And the court threw out the plaintiff's claims that the authorization violated the SRA because the SRA doesn't tell you what you have to have or not have in the authorization. It's just saying you have to get authorization to do the background check. Finally, we're starting to see a creeping rise in criminal history lawsuits. So we talk a lot in these webinars about disclosure lawsuits in particular, adverse action issues. Those are the two reasons employers are sued under the Fair Credit Reporting Act the most. But we do still see cases, and we've started to see more of them, with questions being raised about how employers are actually using criminal history information in their employment decision. And so we've seen several lawsuits filed within the last few months, primarily against banks, which is pretty interesting, but it is still something that employers need to be aware of. And what these lawsuits are saying is the same thing that the EEOC has been saying since 2012 and before, is essentially that the use of criminal history information can negatively or disproportionately impact minority candidates because minority candidates are more likely to have been arrested and convicted. And so there's a whole host of statistics out there that show that. And I think it's part of the broader conversation we're seeing across our country today, right, on you know, criminal justice reform and impacts that racial discrimination has created in a wide variety of situations, not just employment. But this is really what these lawsuits are focused on. So the best thing that employers can start doing is really look at how you use this information in your hiring decisions. You know, are you being cognizant of the EEOC's recommendations to conduct individualized assessments? So looking at each report on a case-by-case basis to determine if that person should be potentially disqualified or not based on that criminal history. You know, is that criminal history job-related? Does it pose a safety risk? How many criminal offenses have there been? How recent has the criminal history been? All of those types of factors are things that a lot of employers, are starting to take a look at. We saw this coming out of the EEOC's $6 million settlement with Dollar General at the end of last year. And Dollar General had been using what's called an adjudication matrix to evaluate consumer reports and then disqualifying people based on that matrix without going through that individualized assessment process. So that cost them $6 million plus ongoing interaction with the EEOC. So a good case to review for employers for sure. So let's now switch to drug testing and marijuana. I do just want to highlight a couple cases to show where some of these cases are landing, because historically, when we started talking about marijuana several years ago becoming legal, not just from a medicinal standpoint, but a recreational standpoint, it was in states like Colorado and Washington, where a lot of the case law was still on the side of the employer. So the employer still had a really broad range of abilities to not allow someone to work there if they couldn't pass a drug test for marijuana. What we see now is kind of a shift the other way to where case law is really going on the side of the employee or the candidate, particularly on the East Coast. So we've seen a lot of cases out of New Jersey, Delaware, Massachusetts, that are actually finding on behalf of the employee. This case in particular I thought was really interesting because it's something that, again, we just haven't seen and probably wasn't even imaginable a few years ago. So in this case, the employee, and a lot of these cases have pretty common facts, but in this case, the employee was working on a construction site. He had a truckload of concrete dumped on him. He was injured. He could no longer work. He went through this several-year-long journey through pain management. And throughout the course of time, or those years, he became a qualified user under the New Jersey medical marijuana law, which was amended last year to become even stronger in favor of candidates. And so the employer did agree to reimburse several medical bills and expenses, but they said we're not reimbursing medical marijuana expenses. Well, the compensation judge determined that, yeah, you do, employer, have to reimburse these medical marijuana expenses. And in doing so, the judge actually looked at the various side effects associated with marijuana versus opioids and looked at the fact that the employee, now former employee, had a history of opioid abuse. And so the judge determined, look, it's really reasonable here to not make this employee go back to the opioid track, but instead work through pain management using medical marijuana. The employer appealed, and upon appeal, the court did uphold the order, determined that the employer had no conflict between complying with New Jersey's law and the Federal Controlled Substances Act, and so the employer was ordered to reimburse that medical marijuana expense. So pretty interesting there. Another case out of New Jersey came from their Supreme Court. Again, someone's injured in the workplace, test positive following a drug test, and actually sued under the New Jersey law against discrimination. And the court allowed this case to move forward. It found that there's no conflict between the New Jersey Medical Marijuana Act and the law against discrimination, and really looked at the fact that, you know, nothing requires the accommodation of medical marijuana in the workplace or requires employers to allow an individual to perform the duties of their role while under the influence. And that wasn't the issue here. So the issue here wasn't the employee was saying, you need to accommodate me at work and allow me to use marijuana at work. It was the fact that they used marijuana in off-duty hours. They tested positive because it's really difficult for, you know, these tests to determine time of use, right? There's no marijuana test that shows time of use necessarily. So again, a common challenge for employers that we're going to see in more states than just New Jersey. Two last cases just to highlight briefly. So in the Pennsylvania case, while this case isn't binding to other areas of the state, it'll be interesting to see if it continues to spread throughout Pennsylvania. But the court here did determine that the plaintiff could file a wrongful termination claim under the Medical Marijuana Act, which is pretty interesting, right? Because that can open up a whole host of wrongful termination claims if, as an employer, you have a routine of terminating individuals for a positive marijuana test. And then in Rhode Island, this was a case out of the Rhode Island Supreme Court. This one actually really looked at reasonable suspicion testing, which is something that is it's a complicated area for employers to navigate, right? So what exactly prompts your right to test someone under that concept of reasonable suspicion? And so there's a lot of testimony exchanged in this case, both by the former employee as well as the supervisors that were there on site. And essentially, the court determined that the Rhode Island drug testing law doesn't require actual knowledge that the employee is under the influence or not. Or that there are specific symptoms displayed, because in the court's opinion, that was requiring the employer to essentially act as a medical professional. Rather, they just have to know that there's reasonable grounds that something is wrong and that the employee may be under the influence. And so it upheld the dismissal as being within the employer's rights based on the fact that the employee refused to submit to a drug test based on that reasonable suspicion. So a lot of content that we covered. We do have plenty of time for questions, so please feel free to submit those. While we wait for some of those to come in, I just want to highlight some resources that Assurant has made available to you, whether you're an Assurant client or not, and because we take thought leadership really seriously. So one of our most popular resources is the 50 State Guide, and that includes every law, ordinance, regulation we could find at a local and state level. It is routinely updated, so it's been updated to reflect some of the laws we discussed today with Maryland and Waterloo as an example. We have a white paper dedicated to marijuana and evaluating background checks, that individualized assessment concept we talked about, as well as various guides to ban the box, credit history, and salary laws. So definitely encourage you to check that out along with our blog. And with that, I will turn it back over for questions.
Okay, so I do have a couple of questions that have come in. For anyone else, please go ahead and submit your question in the chat or Q&A feature. The first question here is, what steps should I be taking to evaluate how the changing laws and trends with marijuana may impact my drugs testing program and policies?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question and one that we definitely have been getting a lot from clients over the last year or so. So I would say, you know, first and foremost, where you hire is incredibly important. So if you're hiring in New Jersey or one of the other states I mentioned, you're potentially facing a tougher road than other states just based on the case law that we've started to see and the way that New Jersey has amended its law to be even tougher for employers. You know, some like New York City, for example, now has a ban on testing for marijuana in a pre-employment context. Nevada has a law specific addressing how pre-employment or employment drug testing for marijuana can be used. So again, first depends on the jurisdiction. If you're not in one of those jurisdictions or you just want to take more of a comprehensive approach, you know, you need to decide how you're going to handle the differing requirements across jurisdictions if you hire in multiple jurisdictions, which many employers, of course, do. So are you going to try and tackle this all in one large drug testing policy and try and go with the most conservative approach? Are you going to instead tackle it with state-specific appendices to your policy, for example? I've seen both be done and to varying levels of success. So, you know, again, legal counsel engagement here will be super important for you because this is a really complex area to navigate. And then also look at, you know, what is your risk tolerance or profile as an organization? And really look at, why do you use marijuana tests in the first place? Like, why are you disqualifying someone for marijuana use or not? You may have a federal requirement to do so, and federal requirements are always going to trump state requirements. You may be hiring people that work with heavy machinery and you have legitimate concerns related to safety, for example, if people were to be working under the influence. Maybe that's different than if you hire primarily in an office location and people who may use marijuana off-duty hours, maybe that doesn't impact their ability to do the role. So really looking at each position type, the industry that you're in, and considering how and why you use marijuana in the first place, those are all good places to start the conversation.
Wonderful. Another question here. When considering criminal history, if you evaluate candidates based on an adjudication matrix, what risks may there be, or is an employer protected because they follow the matrix when making a hiring decision?
Yeah, so that kind of goes back to, you know, some of what we talked about with like the EEOC, for example, in that Dollar General case. But adjudication matrices, you know, for those who may not be necessarily familiar with that term, it's a way that employers have essentially bracketed, you know, certain types of crimes, for example, either by type or level, and, you know, put their essential tolerance in for, do we want someone to move forward with this type of a crime or not? And so it can be a good first step towards evaluating, you know, which reports you might want to take a closer look at, for example. Maybe you don't care about one DUI, but you care if they have three DUIs. And, you know, maybe you only care about DUIs if there's a driving position involved. You know, all of those varying levels of detail can come into play with something like an adjudication matrix. And so, you know, it's a good first step to take. It can potentially help narrow down the amount of reports that you may have to look at thoroughly. Assurant does have a candidate adjudication assistant product available to help with this. So if that's something you're interested in, definitely feel free to reach out and we can give you more information there. But also important to remember that, again, the EEOC is still really focused on the concept of individualized assessments and, you know, look at that Dollar General case, look at past cases with the EEOC, have your matrix reviewed by legal counsel. And it's also important to take a look at not just your matrix, but what terms are you using? Are you still labeling people as a fail or an ineligible, a do not hire? You know, all of those terms are starting to really have a closer look by employers because they of their negative implications, right? This actually has actually been important with the pre-adverse and final adverse action letters as well. And so the adverse action process under the FCRA says you can't make a hiring decision based on a report without following this two-step process. And the first part, the pre-adverse action, is supposed to come before a final decision is made. So there has been some case law out there. It hasn't really settled one way or the other, but the argument by plaintiff's attorneys is that, well, if you're slapping a fail on someone and then sending a pre-adverse action letter, arguably you've already taken adverse action because you marked them as a fail. Because what does fail mean? Fail means fail. Just like ineligible or do not hire don't imply that necessarily that it was a final or not a final decision. And so we've seen a lot of employers move to more neutral terminology like review or under consideration. And so really making clear that the candidate has not been disqualified, they are still being considered, they were sent the pre-adverse action letter, and then using a more final term, potentially, for once the decision is final. So maybe final decision or just final. And so really keeping it more generic than words like fail, do not hire, and ineligible. So just some things to be looking at in your overall program as well.
Wonderful. What if our client is requiring us to go back further than 7 years, but the state won't allow? Is there any way to get around that?
Yeah, this is another question we get a lot from staffing clients, where you may have a really buttoned up compliance program and a great handle on what you can and cannot do, but your clients may not, right? And so it's really coming down to educating your clients on why what they're asking for isn't reasonable or isn't legally possible potentially. So there are several states, and Philadelphia as an example of a city, where there is requirements on how far back either a background screening provider can report criminal information or how far back an employer may use and consider that information. California, Massachusetts are good examples of that. So there's not really a way around these types of laws. There are exceptions under the laws, but they're really pretty limited in scope. So the likelihood that you will be able to rely on an exemption is probably pretty small, but again, talk to your legal counsel there. But I think that's really where you need to just provide that education as to the why to your client. And that's something that, you know, if you're an Assurant client, we're happy to help you with. You know, we have a whole host of resources, FAQ guides, things that can be just shared directly with your client that outlines, you know, why some of these things exist, why these requirements are in place. You know, we're happy to have the discussion with you and your client, you know, whatever's helpful to help you navigate those difficult discussions, because we know you want to maintain and foster those relationships, of course, while also making sure that you meet your own compliance requirements. So whatever we can do to help, we're happy to do. But it really just all comes down to that education and the why behind why you need to go back with a, you know, I don't think this is going to be possible in this scenario.
And as a staffing company, they are ultimately responsible or liable for following the laws related to pulling that type of information, because they are the employer of record. Like, would they not remain responsible for that decision even if it was requested by the client and it was not something that you'd ordinarily be able to do?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, that brings up a great point, and it gets into kind of that tough area that staffing client and our companies work in, right, is who's actually the employer. Are you a joint employer? Who's responsible for FCRA requirements, for example? And so staffing clients or companies in particular really need to be careful about who is taking responsibility for what under things like the Fair Credit Reporting Act, because once you get into the argument of, well, we shouldn't be held liable for this, the other company should, you're kind of already losing, right? Because you're already in that legal discussion on the topic and likely having to engage counsel and pay, and litigation is expensive. So yeah, it's always best to really look at maybe taking a more conservative approach, coordinating with your legal counsel to design your program, making sure you're meeting your compliance requirements, and, you know, staying firm with those despite some pushback you may receive. And that's, again, where that education is really key. Great point.
Wonderful. Any final thoughts that you'd like to share with our audience today, or final takeaways that they should think about in trying to stay current with compliance?
Yeah, I would just want to, first of all, thank everyone for joining. I know time is tight in these days. I hope that this information was helpful for you. Assurant is always happy to follow up with further information. So if you do have any questions, please reach out to Assurant. Our contact information is available on our website, or you can email us at compliance@assurant.com. Assurant is with one S. And, you know, again, happy to help however possible. We really place a strong emphasis on compliance and education, and are happy to take any questions you may have.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to present this webinar to our clients here and for all the attendees who took time out of their day to join us. For information on staying current with compliance, watch for information on our next webinar sessions, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. Thanks, everyone.